initiative of justice.
We've lost Dale Earnhardt.
It's time for me to move on.
Because of the HIV virus, I will have to retire.
Neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team.
The banishment for life of Pete Rose from baseball is the sad end of a saga.
I'm Bob Lee, and welcome to The Headlines. In honor of ESPN's 25th anniversary, we're counting down the 25 biggest stories of the era as voted on by a panel of 100 who have chronicled this period of change. We're examining the headlines that at some point jumped off the sports page and onto the front page. This evening, we'll be reminded about the magical possibilities in sport, those rare moments when our games exceed our wildest expectations. And when you take an event such as that, add the issue of amateurs facing virtual professionals and stir in the lure of the underdog and the searing pressure of the Cold War, you have tonight's headline.
Soviet Union and the United States are fighting Hitler in World War II. We're allies.
General Kapkov would like to know whether you will join him to drink the surrender of Germany.
My compliments to the general. Please inform him that I do not care to drink with him or any other Russian son of a bitch.
There was fear on both sides that arose out of the aftermath of World War II. This was a very complicated political struggle over primacy in the world by two different systems.
An iron curtain had descended across the continent.
The Soviet Union certainly saw itself as the bastion of communism. The United States saw itself as the bastion of capitalism.
Even if there were only one communist in the State Department, that would still be one communist too many.
The sense of competition, of embattlement, of the potential for conflict was, I think, in the psyche of lots of people.
In 1957, the USSR staggered the United States and its allies by establishing a gateway in a new frontier.
On every continent and in every land, the story of Sputnik 1 dominated the front pages. The Soviets had scored a scientific first.
Sputnik was big, but when Yuri Gagarin went into space, that was huge. The feeling of us versus them was definitely big.
Soviet achievements in areas such as space exploration, that was all part of the Soviet propaganda. It was part of a way of projecting their image, part of a way of saying that they were a superpower.
The threat of hydrogen bomb warfare is the greatest danger our nation has ever known.
The Cold War held always the possibility that through miscalculation or a series of miscalculations, that you could end up with a nuclear confrontation.
I call upon Chairman Khrushchev to halt and eliminate this clandestine, reckless, and provocative threat to world peace.
The Cold War was in two parts. One was the nuclear arms race. The other part was the Third World, where we were pretty much in competition.
We intend to convince the communists that we cannot be defeated by force of arms.
Most things where the U.S. and the Soviet Union were involved, everything was connected into something more, whether it was the arms race, whether it was the space race, whether it was Olympic Games.
The curtain rises on the 1952 Olympics. Little Finland is host this time to athletes from all parts of the world on both sides of the Iron Curtain.
As soon as the Soviet Union started entering the Olympics, there was an immediate Cold War awareness. The implication was that this was going to be a battle between ideologies.
Victory in the Olympic Games was important victory for the nation. It was this feeling that we won over the capitalism.
The one thing about the Olympic Games is that they raise a flag and they play an anthem. It's the best way to project to the world that you're a winning country, that you are a powerful country.
In 1968, I'm fighting in the Olympics. And the whole world was about America, superpower, Russia, superpower. Who's gonna win? When you win, it's not like I just want a gold medal. I proved that America is the strongest nation in the world.
There is time for the Russians to go to their big man, Alexander Belov. They're going to try. Alexander Belov. And this time it is over.
Over time, the Soviet Union began to win more medals. You begin to sense that the United States is losing this Cold War battle on the Olympic field.
The diminished Olympic dominance of the United States in the 1970s reflected a deeper feeling that the nation at home and abroad was losing its long-standing economic and moral high ground in more vital areas.
To leave office before my term is completed is abhorrent to every instinct in my body. But as president, I must put the interests of America first. I shall resign the presidency effective at noon tomorrow.
Millions of gas-hungry Americans experiencing the worst weekend yet in the growing gasoline shortage.
Thousands of Muslim demonstrators marched to the United States Embassy. It's the largest demonstration so far since the embassy was seized and the hostages taken 5 days ago.
Massive Soviet military forces have invaded the small, non-aligned, sovereign nation of Afghanistan.
Soviet invasion of Afghanistan took place at the very end of 1979. Jimmy Carter had expressed shock that the Soviets would do anything like that.
It had shaken our confidence as a nation. It had shaken the public's confidence in our administration. There was a sense of helplessness on the part of the nation.
Moscow's intervention in Afghanistan has plummeted Soviet-American relations to probably the lowest point since the Cold War.
Carter, in a real sense, felt betrayed by the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan. Carter had tried to have better relations with the Soviets.
With the Summer Olympics scheduled to open in Moscow in July 1980, President Carter responded.
With Soviet invading forces in Afghanistan, neither the American people nor I will support sending an Olympic team to Moscow.
Suddenly, this one great event that Americans always look forward to, the Summer Olympics, wasn't there. So all that was left was the Winter Olympics.
There weren't a lot of things to get excited about at the time, so something needed to be done to get people excited. Well, if you would have said it was going to be hockey and a group of players and a community of 2,500, somebody would ask you, you know, what drugs are you on?
The Soviets were very good in terms of world hockey, and the U.S. was several steps behind. And the U.S. knew it, the Soviets knew it, the rest of the world knew it.
In the 60s, 70s, and 80s, the three most important things for the Soviet Union, which they thought that they're number one in the world, were hockey, space, and ballet, and in that particular order.
The hockey team was better than everybody else. They won their games with ease. There was nothing to celebrate for them. They were supposed to win.
At that time, hockey was the best of the best. They really was treated much better than anybody else because they always win.
Not always. At the 1960 Winter Games in Squaw Valley, California, the Americans upset the Soviets and went on to win the gold medal. But the USSR rallied with a vengeance, earning hockey gold in four straight Olympics, and doing so with such devastating efficiency that their status as amateurs was called into question.
Technically, the Russians weren't professionals, but their costs were all picked up. They were all subsidized. Most of the players were in the Red Army. They got the officer's salary. They got better housing, better food, especially in a country where these things were rationed, essentially.
You had a car, which was the envy of everyone. And you were feted as a national hero, as only sports people could be.
They told us we gotta show our power, we gotta show our society, our system is better than anybody else.
The overall image that was presented to us in the West was of a cold, mechanistic sports machine.
The
Soviets were so stiff and so regimented in the way they trained and the way they practiced and the way they played. When they'd score a goal, there was very little emotion. It was very businesslike and very robotic.
Russian hockey played a little bit different. Not too many emotion. You score, a Canadian, American, oh, goal, score. No, Russian, but okay, good.
Being away in a training camp facility for year after year, month after month, being away from the family, that's why players maybe kind of became like a robots, because everything been done for them.
By contrast, the 1980 U.S. Olympic hockey team was drawn from the college ranks just 6 months before the games were to begin. Players unknown to all but a few Americans, the best of them considered long shots to make the NHL.
The only American players that were in the NHL at that time were basically fourth line kind of guys or fifth or sixth defensemen. You know, there weren't a whole lot of stars.
I didn't think the NHL was within my grasp, not because it was unwarranted given my talent and my ability, but just because it was sort of a glass ceiling to American players.
Whereas the Canadian kid growing up aspired to play in the National Hockey League, the American kid growing up back then really aspired to play on the Olympic team. The 1980 hockey team were, in fact, true amateurs.
It was not very glamorous. We scrounged around quite a bit to try to get some money raised so that we could have sticks and barter for equipment with companies.
I was like Mike Rizzioni. I was being bounced around a bunch of minor league teams. And at that time, the NHL didn't recognize International Hockey League as a pro team, so we couldn't keep our amateur status and play it. We never gave it up.
We had money to live on. It was nothing. It was minuscule. But we were on our own, playing a professional schedule, really. The end goal was to go out there and make sure that we gave our very best effort every night.
As an athlete, I don't think there's a greater reward than to represent your country in any sport. In a team sport, when you have 20 friends, we all stuck our neck out for each other.
When you walk in the locker room and you see your shirt hanging up and it says USA, and then you go and you see a name on the back, you have no idea what that means until you actually put it on. The sweater is like the flag. It just shows everything that everybody fights and cares for, and it's our dreams.
While the amateurs were preparing to chase their dream of a medal, it was business as usual for the Soviets, who had beaten an NHL All-Star team 2 out of 3 games in February of 1979.
The 79-80 Soviet team was believed to be, they thought, the best team ever put together. Not just the best Russian team, the best team, period. The Americans hadn't done anything.
Playing for the Atlanta Flames, we faced Team USA in Grand Forks and beat them 3-1 and thought, boy, these kids are going nowhere.
The week before the 1980 Winter Games were to begin, the two very different teams played out this drama in an exhibition game at Madison Square Garden.
And I recall looking down the ice, you see Petrov and Karlamov and Mikhailov, and you're going, wow, those are the guys I've been watching on TV for the last 6, 8, 10 years, winning Olympic championships.
The opening faceoff, I looked at Mark Johnson, and he looked at me, and I thought, what in hell are we doing here?
Breaking down the right side is Maltsev. Look at this play. He scored! What a great play by Maltsev!
They toyed with us. It was men against the boys.
Shot in front, score! Oh, what a beating.
After the 10-3 drubbing by the Soviets, U.S. coach Herb Brooks laid out a mission possible for his young players.
We were seeded 7th. It'd be the youngest Olympic team in our country's history and the youngest team there. So you try to be both idealistic and then blend the pragmatics of the situation in.
Before the tournament started, Herbie said, all right, guys, here's the program. If we play at the top of our game and we get some breaks, we can win a bronze medal. If we play at the top of our game and get every break imaginable, we can win a silver. He said, forget the gold. Soviet's going to get the gold.
The chant, USA, USA, started in Lake Placid. It was everybody who believed in our way of living, our way of life.
Thank you.
pleased to declare officially the opening of the 13th Winter Olympics held this year at Lake Placid.
A day before the opening ceremony of the 1980 Games, the American hockey team began group play against Sweden in a half-empty arena. Down 2-1 with 27 seconds to go, the unsung underdog showed signs that just maybe they had the right stuff.
Fighting for control of the puck with 29 seconds to play. Baker on it! Cole Baker with 27 seconds remaining in the game. The Americans tie the Swedes.
I don't think anybody gave us a chance against Sweden, and we tied Sweden. And then, you know, the opening ceremony is the next day, and now people are starting to get a little excited. We're playing Czechoslovakia, and the building's packed.
Harrington tries to center it in front. The Snyder scores! Harrington to Snyder, and it's 6-2. This is incredible.
We beat the Czechs, the only team that anybody thought that could beat the Soviets. And now, all of a sudden, there's a buzz.
All of a sudden, we got some games that, well, we're expected to win.
Kristoff, he scores! Steve Kristoff!
And I would get phone calls all of a sudden from radio stations all over the country saying, hey, can we win the gold? Can we win the gold? I'm thinking, like, you dreamers. No, we can't win the gold. But we have a good chance at the silver.
The U.S. defeated Czechoslovakia, Norway, Romania, and West Germany in a week, earning a berth in the medal round with four victories and a tie. The Soviets were 5-0 and had convincingly beaten these Americans 13 days earlier. They were not impressed.
When the pools ended and the Czechs did not qualify, the chief of the Russian hockey delegation said, guys, we have the gold medals in our pocket.
We worry about only Czech Republic. Other team, we don't worry because we're a strong team. We beat the NHL hockey team.
They were treating some of us not with the respect, and I think in the world of sport, you have to respect all your opponents. So I just kept telling them, someone's going to beat them, someone's going to beat them, someone's going to beat them.
Late in the afternoon of February 22nd, the Americans and the Soviets battled before a roaring partisan crowd. The game was taped by ABC Sports to be broadcast that evening. But many Americans, who only a week earlier could not name a single U.S. player, tuned in for this moment.
We had telegrams plastered on the wall in our locker room from all over the country, and one of them was very simple, beat those commie bastards.
In a political or nationalistic sense, I'm sure this game is being viewed with varying perspectives, but manifestly, it is a hockey game.
Herb captured a feeling of destiny in a pregame speech that he gave before that game. When he sat in the locker room and said, you were born to be here at this moment in time, guys were sitting around thinking, yeah, you know what? This has been written in some big book a long time ago, and we can do this.
On our way out to play the Russians, I stopped just because I was always the first one on the ice, and I just looked left and right and up, and it was overwhelming. The chant, USA, USA, started in Lake Placid. It was everybody who believed in our way of living, our way of life.
The building had energy in it, and it was from us to them and from them back to us.
Despite a sonic avalanche of pro-American energy, the vaunted Soviets took to the ice in full force.
Slap shot, and it was deflected in. The Soviet Union takes a 1-0 lead.
The Russians did score first. For a minute there was, well, here we go again.
The Olympic Games, we came from behind 6 games. So the Russians score, we just dig in and come right back.
Pavlik taking it away. Pavlik up ahead to Schneider. Slap shot goes in! On Schneider!
The Soviets regained the lead 2-1. But late in the first period, fortune smiled on the young Americans.
Davey Christian, takes a shot from the red line just to take a shot with under 5 seconds to go in the period, just to put it on net, and anything can happen.
I think, okay, no time. Maybe 5 seconds, okay, have a bigger rebound.
And all of a sudden, the puck's on my stick.
Long shot, the easy save by Tretiak, but Johnson is there and scores with 1 second to play in the period.
With the score tied at 2, Soviet coach Viktor Tikhonov made a radical move. He replaced Vladislav Tretiak, considered the best goaltender in the world, and brought in Vladimir Mishkin.
Never. And 2-2, Ladislav Tretiak sees a bench. Never in my life.
When their coach, Tikhanov, had pulled Tretiak, that was his way of telling his team, hey, don't screw around with these guys.
The Soviets responded, retaking the lead early in the second period.
We were outshot 12-2 in the second period, and we only gave up one goal. That's inspirational. Now we knew we had a hockey game.
Well, at the end of the second period, sitting in the locker room, guys were just kind of itching to get back on the ice. It was this sense of payback that what they did to us 2 weeks ago.
7 minutes into the third period, the Soviets were called for a penalty.
At that point in the game, there had been a little bit of a lull, and the Soviets had started to take the game to us a little bit. Having a power play would at least give us the opportunity to shift the momentum and create some energy.
13 seconds left in the penalty. He chops it in, scored by Dustin, they score!
The fact that we scored a goal off of what was basically a broken play that happened to end up on Johnson's stick not only got us back into it, but it got the crowd back into it.
And finally, the building has come to life. 3-3.
The crowd, they were that excited. Like, they were with you, and hey, we're going to help you through this thing.
Now I think the game comes into our hands. Now it becomes a game of emotion. Now it becomes a game of conditioning.
In the third period, instead of being tired, the American team were as fresh as in the first, and then I started thinking that something unexpected can happen.
The U.S. team is depending a little bit too much now on Jim Craig. He's making too many good saves. Ruzioni! By Ruzioni! Now we've got Bedlam. That goal coming at the 10-minute mark.
I went out, took a shift, went back, looked up, and it looks like the clock said 9:59. It was a long, long 10 minutes, but we had the lead.
I'm saying, oh my gosh, this is way too much time. To me, it was like banging a bee's nest. All we're going to do now is piss them off.
Golikov skating in. Golikov's backhander, the save by Craig.
I can remember thinking to myself, God, whatever it is, I am not going to be out on the ice when they tie it up or they go ahead.
You dare to hope, and then you hope so hard and are just afraid that the Soviets are going to do what they've done countless times before, just crush your hopes.
225, 224, 223 remaining.
As the clock began to tick down and the minutes became seconds, you could feel it.
28 seconds, the crowd going insane.
And the noise in that building was palpable.
You've got 10 seconds. The countdown going on right now. Morrow, up to Schultz. 5 seconds left in the game. Do you believe in miracles? Yes! Unbelievable.
When the camera showed the eyes of the Soviet players, there was disbelief. They couldn't believe that they lost the game to the college guys.
When I saw the U.S. team, I was happy because I forgot about this feeling.
I remember that night too, like it was hard to go to sleep because you're going like, I don't know if I want to because if I wake up, this might not have happened, you know?
After Iran, after Afghanistan, after inflation, we finally have something to cheer about.
I remember for days, Hungarians, Czechs, immigrants, people who ran away from those countries, dancing in the streets, thrilled. They came as much to cheer against the Soviets as to cheer for us. It was like celebrating the end of a war.
It was one of those moments where we were thrilled beyond belief. We were excited. We were just couldn't believe our underdog team was able to prevail.
That extraordinary Miracle on Ice team brought a great outpouring of patriotism and a sense of the possible.
I watched on television, and it was a real thrill to see the Americans prevail. I really think that it was a 10-strike in the Cold War between the Soviet Union and the United States.
Herbie enters the room and basically gets a message across that, do you understand the magnitude of this game? And his way of saying it was, if you lose this game, you're going to take this to your effing grave.
In the wake of his team's astonishing upset of the Soviets, U.S. coach Herb Brooks had to rally his troops for one more battle.
We knew that we had just beaten the best team in the world. The next day, we cruised into the rink and, you know, Herbie was waiting for us with a baseball bat.
He just beats us with physical practice and, you know, making sure that he makes us mentally aware. It's a time to be refocused.
On Sunday morning, February 24th, the United States faced Finland.
We are live from Lake Placid, the Olympic Ice Center. The United States, it's as simple as this. With a win, they clinch the gold medal.
As the Lake Placid Arena boomed with expectation, the Finns took a 2-1 lead into the second intermission. With 20 minutes left, the U.S. coach explained the long-term effects of a defeat.
Herbie enters the room and basically gets a message across that, do you understand the magnitude of this game? And his way of saying it was, if you lose this game, you're going to take this to your effing grave.
We got up out of our chairs and we walked on the ice. We rode over them like steamrollers.
Johnson to McClanahan, he scores! Johnson skating in the shot, but we can't be score!
We look like the Russians playing against the Americans in Madison Square Garden.
This impossible dream comes true!
When you are in an event where you represent your country on a world stage and you achieve as an underdog the ultimate goal, you get very thankful. And I just remember wishing that my mother was still there. So when the game ended, I just wanted to turn and show respect for my father, that I was thinking of my mother.
Captain Michael Ruzzioni getting his guys up there. Number one, you bet.
We restored the pride and patriotism that makes this country so great, not even knowing it.
When a young underdog American Olympic team showed that the spirit of America is still very much alive.
It didn't really dawn on me as to the true impact until we went to Washington, D.C. the following day to see the president. And the streets were lined, not just by individuals, but they were 10 people deep. And not just for 20 yards, but for miles.
While joy rippled like a flag across the United States, the Soviet team went home to face their stunned comrades who had questions for which there were no adequate answers.
The hockey fan, 4 years, asked me, why you lose? Why you lose? Why? 4 years.
In Kremlin, after the Olympics, they usually have the reception that Tikhonov was talking to Brezhnev and telling him, like, it will never happen again, and, you know, it was just a fluke. I remember, like, Brezhnev hung him like this and said, Victor, don't worry, I know that you're better than Americans. There was no punishment. Nobody was sent to Siberia.
While the Soviets returned to form, winning gold in the next two Olympics, the legacy of these miraculous Americans included a sea change in the professional ranks.
After the success of the 80 team, all the NHL guys went wild and started drafting every American. All of a sudden, our guys were good enough.
The players that came up in the early to mid-80s, you know, even to the late 80s and into the 90s, were beneficiaries of that sort of groundswell.
Made me want to be an Olympian, made me want to be an NHL player, made me want to be Mike Ruzzioni.
We might have opened the door, but these guys have knocked it down and proven that Americans can flat out play this game. And it's nice to know that they look at us as somewhat of an inspiration.
If the miracle of Lake Placid inspired American players to reach for the NHL, it also produced an unrealistic level of expectation for homegrown Olympians.
There were a lot of pressures on USA Hockey to manage, you know, kind of the afterglow of 1980. The expectations, just the reception that the 84 team would get in its pre-tournament, it was almost set up to fail.
Can it be done again? 4 years later, the United States seeking another gold medal here in Sarajevo.
ABC's out there selling these games in 84 as Miracle on Ice Chapter 2. We said, there ain't going to be no miracle.
Harry Wilson, number 20. This is their top line. He has Flatley out in front, and Flatley scores. And just like that, 27 seconds into the game, it is 1-0 Canada.
Beginning with an unmiraculous seventh place finish in 1984, the U.S. began a stretch of five winter games without gaining a medal. But what happened at Lake Placid in 1980 foreshadowed a new dawn.
Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
Communism everywhere is dead or dying. The Cold War is over. The Soviet Communist Party has expired, mortally wounded by its own hand.
With the formal breakup of the Soviet Union in 1991, an Olympic rivalry that captivated the world for more than two generations became just a memory.
The USA versus the Soviet Union hockey game was the last vestige of the old era. It was, to some degree, the last real Cold War event at the Olympic Games.
We'd be naive to say that it hasn't diminished some aspect of the television attraction. Americans like to see us beat the Soviets. Now that aspect has been removed, and some of the edge is gone.
I see. The U.S. now at an Olympic event, they chant this USA, USA, beating their chests. We're now the only superpower standing. And we come across as these bullies.
What the collapse of the Soviet Union ironically did was that it forced the movement to professionalism and making it a true world championship, not one for some amateurs and a couple of people from the communist bloc, that has allowed the Olympics to continue to be this attraction.
In February 2002, the Winter Games returned to the U.S. for the first time since the Miracle on Ice. Just 5 months after 9/11, a nation's emotions were lifted when the 1980 hockey team lit the Olympic torch in Salt Lake City.
The whole country in 1980 got behind that team when the world was a very unfriendly place. It's become a very unfriendly world again today, sadly. And just seeing those young men from 1980, I think, resonated throughout the stadium.
It brings into focus how much those 2 weeks in February in 1980 changed my life and changed our lives. It's not who we are, but it is what we did.
For the 2002 Olympics, Herb Brooks came out of retirement to coach a U.S. team composed of NHL players. In the semifinals, the Americans met the descendants of their old foes.
Herb took pains to say, no, 1980 was 1980. This is a different group of players that I'm coaching, a different group of players we're playing against. I think even had we won the gold medal in Salt Lake, there's always only going to be one miracle on ice.
Every time I've been asked, could this be the next miracle? And I just want to tell them, shut up. You know, there is never going to be another miracle. You can't put all those stars into alignment.
Although the U.S. Olympians beat the Russians 3-2, they lost to the Canadians in the final. 18 months later, Herb Brooks was killed in a car crash in Minnesota.
When Herb passed on, I think it made us realize and cherish how special he was. He orchestrated the greatest sports moment of the 20th century. And he taught so many of us players lessons that we've carried on in our lives today.
I'm sick and tired of hearing about what a great hockey team the Soviets have. Screw them. This is your time.
The movie Miracle opened 24 years after the real-life version. Its message remained powerful enough to draw those who remember the upset and to inspire a new generation as well.
Sports show us what we want to see, the best in terms of our courage and our heart.
When you can be that much of an underdog and give the kind of performance that the U.S. team has had, that's very remarkable.
Americans don't like being thought of as being overbearing, being arrogant, being everything the world now accuses us of being. And what people love about the 1980 team, we were the underdog good guys. What the players still hear now is, you made me feel good about my country.
Picked up by Ruzioni, cuts in, shoots, goal! The goalie won!
How many times can you touch somebody's lives in a way that we did through a sporting event? So many people to this day still write me letters or talk to me or pull me aside on the street and want to know what it was like. I want to shake my hand and say thank you.
3, 2, 1! The U.S. has beaten Russia!
This team and this event and this victory led people to dream bigger dreams in all walks of life. There's always going to be challenges in life, whether it's gas lines or it's hostages or it's terrorism. When an event can come up, where it just makes you just feel really good about yourself. It never gets old. It will always be important to people.
You believe in miracles? Yes!
Coming up, I'll be joined by Michael Wilbon and Tony Kornheiser to discuss the hype or the absence of hype leading into the showdown between the Americans and the Soviets at Lake Placid.
We continue with the headlines on ESPN 25. I'm Bob Lee. Each week at this time, I'm joined by Tony Kornheiser and Michael Wilbon. And when folks vote on historical lists, inevitably they seem to skew to the present. It's only human nature. But in this event, 1980, almost a quarter century, it reaches out and still screams to us with some sense of importance.
Well, I mean, at the time, if you were alive and conscious of sports and politics at the time, you know that the United States was in this terrible down period. The hostages had been taken by Iran. We were fighting with the Soviet Union when they went into Afghanistan, long before we went into Afghanistan. And they have this hockey team that is a pro hockey team. We weren't sending pros to the Olympics then. We were sending college kids. And hockey's not even our sport. And they are the original Big Red Machine. That one moment, with all the political overtones that the Olympics have always had, and us beating the mighty Soviet team at that point, that galvanized the country in a way that I never thought would be possible for hockey. Never!
You know what, Tony, what's interesting about that? I grew up in a hockey place, a place where hockey's popular, in Chicago. I played hockey growing up. But you know what? No one paid attention to that game before it was played. There was no buildup. I was in Columbus, Ohio. I was still in college at Northwestern, covering a Ohio State Northwestern University basketball game. I stayed over for Iowa coming in town. And people didn't even know the game was going to be played. And the game had already been played. It was tape delayed. Can you think of something so huge being tape delayed?
I had an entirely different experience.
It was like the NBA.
I was driving from my home to the Capitol Center in the outskirts of Washington, D.C., driving on the...
Oh, so you hadn't planned to watch the game?
No, I knew it was on tape delay. Mm-hmm. Driving on the Beltway, and I had it on radio. Spontaneously, on this great road, people started flashing their lights and honking their horns.
People were aware of it then. The nation's capital, the most politically aware stretch
this
of land
sports,
in America.
This is sports.
I was in Columbus, Ohio. And there was no buzz of it.
Then why
the buzz came later.
Then why
later.
Do you believe in miracles? Why is that such a famous call? Why over
in
20...
In retrospect, when people finally heard it,
why 20 years later would they make this movie Miracle?
Because I'm not saying it doesn't resonate. I'm saying there was no run-up. There was no lead-in. If there had been any lead-in, the game today, in this climate, be on tape delay?
No, but if you look at the totality of it, all the way from Mike Ruzioni, who did the smartest thing by staying married to the Olympic team and not going into the NHL, when he brings his teammates up, when you have the iconic photograph of Jim Craig, the goalie, wrapping himself in the flag.
This is all great.
This thing lives beyond anything you can imagine.
I knew the game was going to be on tape delayed, and I watched it because I actually knew it was coming on and loved every second of it, knew it in advance. What I'm saying to you, I'm not trying to negate
the mythic nature of it.
It started after people got wind of it. I would be interested in finding out what the ratings for the tape delay were, considering so many people were honking their horns and they already knew. My point is, I'm not disagreeing with anything you're saying about the enormity of the moment and of the event. I'm just saying it came later. It was not Ali Frazier, galvanized, separated
that's a
nation.
That's a title fight. This is a tournament where you play, you know, 4 games in 7 days or something like that. It couldn't be like that. But yes, you're right. Before the Olympics started, nobody gave the hockey team a chance. Even when they won the first couple of games.
Nobody gave them a chance.
And they gave them no chance. And that's why the fact that this team of plucky lads. I don't want to do Henry V here. This band of brothers. The fact that they actually beat the greatest team ever assembled in hockey made it an explosive moment in sports.
Absolutely.
That to this day is still number one.
All I'm saying to you is the part of the greatness of the event is that nobody knew until after it happened.
This game had the flag, it had geopolitics, it had the set of America,
it had
Russia, the U.S., it had it all.
It had a backstory that was compelling in and of itself.
And people figured out that backstory 24 hours later.
And it resonates 24 years later.
Yes, it does.
Stick to that position.
Yes, it does.
Stick to your position. You'd be the only one out there not
leaving,
but you stay there.
And he's sticking to it. In just a second, perspective on that great event in Lake Placid from Walter Cronkite as we continue on ESPN 25.
Walter Cronkite cares. You should care.
He didn't even know the game was played either.
The U.S. sends the greatest team ever assembled.
I thank you for your support.
We're holding up to zero tolerance.
A man wielding a knife lunged at her from behind. Why?
Go! Tyson had forced non-consensual sex with the victim.
Advantage, Miss Williams.
Ben Johnson tests positive for steroids.
I love you, Leonard, and I'll see you in heaven one day.
We've lost Dale Earnhardt.
This has to be the greatest comeback in any sport.
All I can say to all of you is I'm really sorry.
Ours will not go.
Cal Ripken Jr. breaks Lou Gehrig's record.
The classic showdown, Bird against Magic.
I have known since 1988 that I have AIDS.
Sporting events are absolutely meaningless.
I'm innocent.
Dance! 62!
I did not bet on baseball.
I am going to go on, I'm going to beat it, and I'm going to have fun.
A win for the ages.
Mr. Simpson is a fugitive of justice.
You believe in miracles? Yes!
As we complete this edition of the headlines, we turn for a closing word from a gentleman who has defined and distinguished his profession for six decades, former CBS News anchor Walter Cronkite.
Back in 1980, when the Americans beat the high-powered Soviets, there's no question it was more than a hockey victory. But I never thought the so-called miracle on ice was a miracle. Religious terms used loosely always have made me just a little uneasy. And perhaps now, more than ever, when terrible things are being justified in the name of faith. The word miracle implies a divine intervention, in this case, being ultimately chosen for an Olympic gold medal because God is on our side. I also never thought that the United States beating the Soviet Union in a game was a metaphor of American might, not even during the Cold War when we grasped for expressions of power that did not include weapons of mass destruction. Having covered World War II, I had some idea what American might was all about. To inject a sports event with those attributes of courage and sacrifice would be too trivializing to the memory of D-Day and Iwo Jima. But I did think that the game was important. Important then, and in some ways even more important now, for the same reasons. In 1980, we were still haunted by our nightmare in Vietnam. Americans had died, perhaps in vain. We had lost trust in leaders who led us into the quagmire and couldn't get us out. The country became a house divided. It was easy to lose confidence in ourselves. The lesson of that Olympic hockey game was a reassuring one. A lesson we could use to help heal ourselves then and now. The lesson was this: a group of Americans under a strong leader working very hard together toward an admirable, peaceful goal could achieve a victory within internationally sanctioned rules. In my view, that lesson is even greater value to us today when the stakes for ourselves and the world are so dangerously high, and the ice is so dangerously thin.
Mm-hmm. That's the biggest headline of the last 25 years as voted on by our panel of experts. Thank you for watching the headlines. I'm Bob Lee.